My brothers and sisters, we gather for worship in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
As we prepare to celebrate the mystery of Christ's love, let us acknowledge our failures and ask the Lord for pardon and strength, first keeping a moment of quiet reflection. and in power. Hold us fast to your promises of peace, won for us by your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
A reading from the letter to the Romans. Therefore, do not let sin exercise dominion in your mortal bodies to make you obey their passions. No longer present your members to sin as instruments of wickedness, but present yourselves to God as those who have been brought from death to life, and present your members to God as instruments of righteousness. For sin will have no dominion over you, since you are not under law, but under grace. What then? Should we sin because we are not under law, but under grace? By no means. Do you not know that if you present yourselves to anyone as obedient slaves, you are slaves of the one whom you obey? Either of sin, which leads to death, or of obedience, which leads to righteousness. But thanks be to God that you, having once been slaves of sin, have become obedient from the heart to the form of teaching to which you were entrusted, and that you, having been set free from sin, have become slaves of righteousness. I am speaking in human terms because of your natural limitations. For just as you once presented your members as slaves to impurity and to greater and greater iniquity, so now present your members as slaves to righteousness for sanctification. When you were slaves of sin, you were free in regard to righteousness. So what advantage did you then get from these things of which you are now ashamed? The end of these things is death. But now that you have been freed from sin and enslaved to God, the advantage you get is sanctification. The end is eternal life. For the wages of sin is death. But the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. For the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Praise be to thee, O Christ. May I speak in the name of God, who is Father. Hospitality is an important theme running through the Christian tradition. In his rule for the monastic life, St. Benedict enjoins his followers to welcome strangers at the monastery door as if they're welcoming Christ himself. Monastic hospitality continued throughout to the Reformation and beyond. And even in our cathedrals, which were previously monastic houses, particularly those with a Benedictine heritage, that sense of Benedictine hospitality continues. Whilst I was training for the priesthood, I spent 6 months working with a brilliant, eccentric, and extremely funny Irish Roman Catholic nun in Sheffield, who, in the absence of a Roman Catholic priest, ran the local Roman parish. A parish which was linked ecumenically with the Church of England parish, which is why I was there. She lived in the presbytery next to the church. Sister Eileen is a first-class example of Christian ministry. Even in those days, in the mid-1990s, the then Roman Catholic Bishop of Hallam would often introduce Eileen to others as, "This is Sister Eileen, one of my parish priests." Note the irony. Regularly, I'd turn up at Holy Family Presbytery for a meeting, and it would end up with a lovely home-cooked meal being provided for this poor, underfed, trainee priest. And I also ought to add that Sister Eileen's strawberry pavlovas were to die for. After my ordination 18 months later, and serving my curacy in Stockport in North Cheshire, I'd often, on a Sunday evening, head over the hills, the Pennines, and spend Monday my day off catching up with this eccentric, lovable, and wonderful nun. Whilst I was doing that, I discovered that her sense of Christian hospitality now extended to asylum seekers from both Ethiopia and Eritrea. From Eileen, Ethiopian Christian Copts and Eritrean Muslims were both offered the warmth of an Irish welcome, eating at the same table. Hospitality is the hallmark of a true follower of Christ. And it was repaid. A couple of years later, when I was in my first living, Jill and I were engaged. Eileen came over the hills to see us. She drove, but had with her one of those Eritrean asylum seekers. A Muslim, he came with Eileen to make sure she was all right. A long winter once ended. Spring arrived, and in a village, all along the main street, people began to rejoice. They began to draw back their curtains and open their windows. After the cold, dark winter, fresh air, warmth, and sunlight began pouring into their homes. And then, a beggar appeared at the end of the village street, and he was soon spotted from the open windows. One by one, each window on the street began to close. The doors were barred. The man knocked on every door, and not one of them was opened to him. Forlornly, he left that street and the village and moved on to another. And once he'd gone from sight, those net curtains began to twitch. The windows opened and the doors unbarred. Once again, fresh air and sunshine poured into the houses, and once again, people rejoiced. Strange, isn't it, how our homes are always open to receive God's sun and fresh air, but not always open to receive a child of God, especially one who comes in poverty. Christ urges us to be hospitable, and nowadays hospitality is very different from what it was in years gone by. When I was growing up in a village in South Cheshire, doors were often at least left open, if not unbarred. Yet today we have alarm systems, guard dogs, bolts, chains, CCTV cameras, electric gates. Yet today, there is more need for hospitality and friendliness. In the world of today, there are far too many who are strangers, far too many who are displaced in some way. The church on the other side of Greater London, in the Diocese of Chelmsford, actually has as its strapline, Home of Refugee Welcome. As Christ pointed off out so often in the Gospels, hospitality to a friend is no big deal. There's no risk involved, and there's every likelihood that the favour will in some way be returned. But hospitality to a stranger is a great thing. For you don't owe anything to a stranger, and there's more of a sense of risk. But Christ calls us to welcome the strangers in our midst. Christ calls us to show hospitality to those in need. To be hospitable doesn't mean trying to make them like us. It means accepting them as they are. And that enables them to share their strangeness and to become valued and loved members of the community. If we as Christians get ourselves into ghettos where we secure ourselves against those whom are seen as different, then what hope is there for the world? Christ, you see, calls us to reach out. He calls us to look beyond the confines of our secure environment. And when that happens, the rewards are enormous. In our Gospel passage this morning, he makes it plain that even the seemingly trivial act of kindness, such as the gift of a glass of cold water, will not go unrewarded. There are, of course, earthly rewards. But there are greater ones as well. Growth in understanding, friendliness, cooperation, the very things which our neighbourhoods are crying out for. These last few months have seen the most extraordinary acts of kindness across our nation and beyond. And perhaps a positive thing to come out of this pandemic will be that increased sense of hospitality towards both friend and stranger. For us as Christians, hospitality isn't an optional add-on. It's not that extra to Christian discipleship. It is at the very heart of the gospel. And the ultimate motivation is clear, as Benedict reminds us, to welcome a stranger is to welcome Christ himself. Ultimately, hospitality isn't about open doors or windows, important though they are. It's about having open hearts. And yes, there is a risk in having an open heart. For an open heart can get hurt. But to open one's heart is to begin to live. To close it is to begin to die. Amen. So we now affirm our faith in God who is love, who calls us and who welcomes us. My brothers and sisters, do you believe and trust in God the Father, source of all being and life, the one for whom we exist?
We believe and trust in him.
Do you believe and trust in God the Son, who took our human nature, died for us, and rose again?
We believe and trust in him.
Do you believe and trust in God the Holy Spirit, who gives life to the people of God and makes Christ known to the world?
We believe and trust in him.
This is the faith of the Church.
This is our faith.
We believe and trust in one God,
Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen. So in union with Christ, and in the power of the Spirit, let us pray to the Father. Generous God, your love bids us welcome. Give to your Church an open heart. Continue to pray within the diocese for the Deanery of Battersea. We pray today for the parish of St. Barnabas, Clapham Common. Richard Taylor and Anne Brodie, the clergy. Within the Anglican Communion, for the United Church of North India, for the Most Reverend Dr. Prem Chand Singh, its moderator. Give thanks for this patch of holy ground here. Pray your blessing upon the preparations being made to reopen for public worship in 2 weeks. Unite your gathered people into a true fellowship of your Son. Lord, in thy mercy, hear our prayer. Generous God, your Son gave a model of simple charity. Transform our governments with such willing compassion. We pray for all whose Christian vocation is lived out in the political sphere. For all local and national and international leaders, that they may act with integrity, justice, and for the good of all. May the hungry find food shared, and the thirsty be revived. Lord, in thy mercy, hear our prayer. Generous God, break down the barriers that divide communities and increase hostilities. Extend the hands of friendship to soften human hearts. remove all that diminishes people's worth. Lord, in thy mercy, hear our prayer. Generous God, pour out your love and compassion on all who cry, how long, O Lord? Continue to pray for those who are sick in body, mind or spirit. All those whom we know to be in particular need, and all who have asked for our own personal prayers. We pray for all who have been prayed for in church this last week. Shine your light into the darkness. Lord, in thy mercy, hear our prayer. Generous God, receive with mercy and forgiveness all who have died. We remember all who have died in recent days, and all whose anniversary falls at about this time, including Alma Chipley and May Craig. Comfort those who grieve, and bring us to share in the reward of the righteous. Lord, in thy mercy, hear our prayer. We pray in particular at this weekend for all who would have been ordained to the diaconate or priesthood, particularly those in this diocese. For those who have been on an interim basis licensed as lay ministers before their ordination as deacons in the coming months. For those preparing for ordination to the priesthood within this deanery, for Hannah Gordon and Paul Fitzpatrick. For those training for ordination, for Helga Zunderbaker, for Sarah Cork, as she prepares to start her training in the autumn. Lord, in thy mercy, hear our prayer. So we come before you now in a moment of quiet and make our own personal prayers. Rejoicing in the fellowship of Blessed Mary, Saint Irenaeus, Saint Peter and Paul, and all the saints, we commend ourselves and the whole of creation to your unfailing love. Merciful Father,
accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ. Amen.
Christ is our peace. If anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. The old has passed away, behold, the new has come. My brothers and sisters, wherever you find yourselves this morning, the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And with thy spirit.
So we offer each other a sign of Christ's peace.
Thank you.
Blessed art thou, Lord God of all creation. Through thy goodness we have this bread to offer, which earth has given and human hands have made. It will become for us the bread of life.
Blessed be God forever.
Blessed art thou, Lord God of all creation. Through thy goodness we have this wine to offer, fruit of the vine and work of human hands. It will become our spiritual drink. Blessed God
forever.
So, Father, we remember all that Jesus did. In him, we plead with confidence his sacrifice made once for all upon the cross, bringing before you the bread of life and cup of salvation. We proclaim his death and resurrection until he comes in glory. Great is the mystery of faith.
Thank you.
Let us pray. O God, whose beauty is beyond our imagining, and whose power we cannot comprehend, show us your glory as far as we can grasp it, and shield us from knowing more than we can bear, until we may look upon you without fear, through Jesus Christ, our Saviour. Amen. The notices are very much as printed in the weekly newsletter, which is now up on Facebook, and it will be up soon on the parish website as well. One or two things just to draw to your attention. Please do continue to spread the word about both the Facebook group and our Twitter page and the website, and we will be continuing to stream all of our services live as we move into the next phase of coming out of the lockdown. And that next phase officially starts next week, next Sunday, but for us we're putting it back a week. So our first act of public worship will be on Sunday the 12th of July, 2 weeks today. We will be, in a sense, for quite some time, I suspect, replicating what we are doing at the moment. So Mass will be celebrated at 10 a.m. here in church, Compline at 9 p.m. When the government lifted the restrictions allowing places of worship to reopen for public worship, restrictions have been placed on us. We're still waiting to hear officially some of the guidelines that the National Church and the Diocese are issuing. However, we are going to have to limit the numbers who attend each time. If you are intending to come to Mass on the 12th, please will you either telephone or email Marion, the parish administrator, so that we can just keep a tally. If we get huge numbers wanting to come and we can't fit everyone in for the one service, then we will look at potentially doing two Masses on a Sunday. The bridge will be up online very soon. It was taking quite some time to upload a little earlier this morning. Hopefully it will be there by the time I get back to the rectory. You will have seen Sarah Cornick, who is both known to both 9 a.m. and 10:30 congregations, heard from Bishop Christopher on Friday that she has been recommended to train for full-time ministry in the Church of England, and she will begin her formation for the priesthood sometime in the autumn. She's going to begin to have conversations with the diocesan vocations team as to how that will look. But to Sarah, huge, huge congratulations. You continue to be surrounded with our love and our prayers as you move into this next phase of your journey. It was, for me, 22 years ago today, on Sunday, the 28th of June, the feast of St. Irenaeus, Bishop of Lyon, that I was made deacon by the then Bishop of Chester, alongside a man who's going to be the next Bishop of Chester. So we pray for you, Sarah, as you move towards your ordination as deacon and as priest, as we continue to pray too for Helga as she begins to enter the final year of her training. The other notices are very much self-explanatory and on the notice sheet. Just to highlight one final thing, if there is anything you would like prayed for at Mass, be it a thing, a person, a situation, please do drop me a line, an email, or give me a ring, and I will very happily remember that prayer intention at the altar, perhaps on a particular day. I think that those are all the notices, except, of course, just to say that for those who've signed up for it, there will be Zoom coffee at 11:30. The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Christ, who has nourished us with himself, the living bread, and the true vine, make you one in praise and love, and raise you up at the last day. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among you, and remain with you this day and always. Amen.
Amen.
Go in the peace of Christ.
Thanks be to God.